Welcome back to the channel, ladies and gentlemen. Boss the Hunter here. First of all, I just want to say thank you so much for all your support this last week or so. Just getting this channel started, I've had so many great Star Wars conversations with you guys. You guys are on there liking, sharing, commenting, viewing the shorts. I can't tell you how much I appreciate it, so thank you. If you haven't subscribed yet, please consider doing so. I want to keep bringing you guys great Star Wars content, so hit that like button, hit that subscribe, hit that notification bell. I know everybody asks you this, but it does help me a ton. Today we're going to be doing something a little bit different. I have been watching the Ahsoka trailer, and I have some thoughts on this show. I really think this show is a make it or break it for Disney Plus Star Wars, and I'm going to tell you guys why. There's a lot going into the show. Disney is clearly betting it all. They're going all in, and I'm going to talk about why I feel that's the case and the future of Disney Star Wars. So sit back, relax, and let's talk about some Star Wars. We don't need that scum. So when you're talking about Disney Plus Star Wars shows, I think the only natural place to start is with The Mandalorian Season 1. I mean, this is what made Disney Plus Star Wars a thing. This is what sold it to people. And I stand by it to this day. I think The Mandalorian Season 1 is some of the best Star Wars that's ever been made. The show is a very simple story about a man, a rugged warrior, fighting his way through the galaxy, doing his job, working, trying to protect his legacy, protect his people, who runs into an innocent creature who can't defend itself in Grogu. And he has a compassion for this as a foundling himself for this abandoned creature with no family, with no species to call his own, and sets out to protect this creature. And their bond and their relationship building is the story. We don't need a big, massive story in Season 1 or Season 2, really, where it over-encompasses all of Star Wars and affects the fate of the galaxy. We have everything we need in these two characters. And then you throw in some great supporting characters like Quill, IG-11, Greef Karga, Cara Dune, and you have a fantastic show that really sets up a simple but effective Star Wars story that's emotional, gripping, and, I mean, let's be honest, action-packed, making some of the best Star Wars that we've seen to this day. There's a little more debate online of Season 2 of The Mandalorian and its quality, but I stand by it as saying that it is still an excellent season. It does bring in more fan-favorite characters. We get Bo-Katan, we get Ahsoka, and we get to see what these characters have been doing since their appearances in Rebels and Clone Wars and find out more about their backstories and their goals and objectives. And I think it adds a lot to the overall Mandalorian story and even to Star Wars building this larger narrative. So where does the fall in Disney Plus Star Wars come? And I think it's without debate that it is Boba Fett, the Book of Boba Fett. Listen, I love Boba Fett. I grew up reading Boba Fett comics, novels, every little bit of information I could get on this character. I loved the bounty hunters of Star Wars. I love the underworld. I love the criminal element. I love the Hutts and Tatooine and all these various gangsters and vile, awful mobsters and criminals and mercenaries and bounty hunters. And Boba Fett was the king of that. He was sold all throughout the expanded universe when I was growing up as the greatest bounty hunter in the galaxy. There was no Cad Bane. There was no Jango then. It was Boba Fett. He was the man. Abosk, IG-88, you know, Forwom, Zuckuss, they couldn't hold a candle to him. They could try, but he was always going to win. And I think what really happened with the Book of Boba Fett, I think it's pretty obvious what happened, is Disney got extremely greedy. They saw the money they were making from The Mandalorian, and they said, we got to get more guys in Mandalorian armor on Disney Plus now. Not only that, we got to dedicate 2 full episodes of The Book of Boba Fett to Din Djarin and The Mandalorian just to set up for Season 3. And I think it's very easy to see that they rushed this show. You had one of your most iconic characters in Star Wars history, and you rushed it to create a very sloppy story that brought in some great characters that you could have done a lot with. I mean, they brought in Black Kay. They brought in Cad Bane, for God's sakes. You could have made a fantastic Star Wars show with a Western criminal setting, or like a mob boss setting, that could have been epic. But it was clear that this was made to get on the screen and on Disney Plus as fast as possible to retain subscribers and to set up for The Mandalorian Season 3. And I don't think there's a lot of debate that The Book of Boba Fett is, in my opinion, the worst Disney Plus Star Wars show. And I hate to say that because I love Boba Fett. I love Cad Bane. They could have had an amazing show together, but instead we got a sloppy mess that just, it really takes away from Boba Fett's legacy, which is really unfortunate to say. So how does Disney follow up the Book of Boba Fett? Well, they bring in an even more iconic character, Obi-Wan Kenobi, who I would argue at this point is the most popular character in Star Wars. You know, back in the day, you would have been Luke, maybe Han. But the fact is, Obi-Wan at this point has been in so much. I mean, he's an original trilogy character. He's a prequel character. He's a Clone Wars character. The man has been everywhere and done everything and has a huge fan base. So it only makes sense to bring Obi-Wan in and make something out of his character, make a new property, especially when you get Ewan McGregor back. Because fans were demanding that for years. They said, bring this man back, make him Obi-Wan. So when Disney announced it, it was a brilliant move. But again, it feels like the show was rushed. There's comics that cover Obi-Wan in that time period that we see in the Obi-Wan show, where he is protecting Luke from the shadows on Tatooine, and they're excellent. The problem is that that's not the show we got. We got a show with Obi-Wan jumping around the galaxy with toddler Princess Leia, you know, fighting Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers. Like, what are we watching, Disney? What are you doing? And I don't hate Obi-Wan like some people do. I think it had some good parts. I'm not just going to crap all over the thing saying it didn't do anything right. I think that the confrontation with Vader wasn't as bad as a lot of people say. I did not like Reva. I thought Reva was a garbage character that we didn't need because we have other Inquisitors who are established, including the Grand Inquisitor, who's in the show. So why would you create a whole new Inquisitor who is very unlikable? Force them into this show and make them the main enemy of Obi-Wan Kenobi. He deserves more than that. Honestly, no Inquisitor should be standing up to Obi-Wan Kenobi at this point. I mean, for evidence of that, look at how he finished off Darth Maul in Rebels. Obi-Wan is the Jedi Master. He is the epitome of what it means to be a Jedi Master in both physicality and combat and in spirituality. He's reached another level, and that's why he is an iconic character. He is the Jedi to look at and say, that is the example. So to take your most popular character, arguably, and then again, rush a show that just does not do him justice was such an epic mistake. So after making messy, rushed shows of two of their most iconic characters, what's Disney's next move for Star Wars? Well, how about we take a character who isn't popular in the universe at all, really, and we make a really well-done show, and that's Andor. You know, people give Andor a lot of crap, but I think it's a very slow-burn show that is extremely well-written. If you sit down and watch Andor, it, again, is telling a small story, much like the first season of The Mandalorian. It's not big. It's not covering, you know, gigantic events in the galaxy. But it is very well told and very well laid out structurally and makes for a really entertaining watch. It is slow. I think there's definitely a reason they released three episodes at once for the premiere, because I think they knew one episode might leave people a little, you know, wanting more, a little bored, a little like, where is this going? But when you sit down and watch Andor, you are getting some really, really quality Star Wars. And it's just shocking that after rushing Boba Fett, rushing Obi-Wan with these iconic, long-lasting characters, you take Cassian Andor, who, let's be honest, is half of Kyle Katarn, the other half being Kanan Jarrus, and you make a really great show about him. Now, don't get me wrong. I like Cassian. I liked Rogue One. You know, I would have preferred to have a Kyle Katarn character in there, but if we're not getting Kyle Katarn, I think the Rogue One crew does a solid job. So that was a really good plus for Disney to move into it. The problem is that Andor's not bringing the crowds. Andor didn't bring the fans, he didn't bring the views, because he doesn't have a fan base. So you basically wasted a really well-written Star Wars show on a character who's just not going to draw the crowd. And then, of course, we come to the last live-action show before we reach Ahsoka, and that is The Mandalorian Season 3. Now, listen, I'm not going to sit here and tell you The Mandalorian Season 3 is fantastic Star Wars, but I don't hate it. I know a lot of people do. I know the views dropped substantially. I know that the studio was concerned with the way the show was going, and the season has problems. It is the Bo-Katan show now at this point. I don't hate that. I am a huge fan of Bo-Katan. I love Bo-Katan. The problem kind of being, this was Din Djarin's story, and that's the character we've grown close to, him and Grogu, and we want to see what happens with them. And it feels like Disney just kind of ran out of things to do with them and pushed the Bo-Katan Taking Back Mandalore story. Again, I don't hate this season. I think some of the stuff that people complained about was actually pretty good. I really liked the finale episode, for instance, with the big battle on Mandalore. I didn't hate that at all. I know a lot of people did, and that's fine. Everybody's entitled to their opinion. But to me, it wasn't awful, but it was not the quality we've seen in the last two Mandalorian seasons, which is concerning because this has been their flagship show. This has been the show that's been dragging Disney Star Wars along and keeping it alive up until this point. So if you're losing that show, what's going to happen next? And that is where we get into Ahsoka. So why do I feel that Ahsoka is the make or break show for Disney plus Star Wars, and maybe Star Wars as a whole? Well, I think to answer that, you have to first look at Disney. Disney is losing money. There's no doubt about that. Marvel is on the decline. Star Wars is on the decline. They're having to remove shows from their platform just to save money so they don't have to pay royalties. They developed the entire Willow show, which they invested a lot of money into, only to have it removed a year later because no one is watching it, and they're having to pay royalties to the original creators that they literally just cannot afford at this point. They have to save money. So if you look at Ahsoka, if you watch the trailer, which I highly recommend you do, look at some breakdowns of it, what are we really getting in that trailer? Well, I'll tell you what we're getting. We're getting three totally separate Star Wars stories, all very iconic, combined. One, we're getting Ahsoka Tano. Now, lover or hater, Ahsoka has become one of the most popular characters in Star Wars, without a doubt, after Clone Wars. And that's coming from someone who, when I originally started watching Clone Wars, I didn't think I was going to like Ahsoka. I thought Ahsoka was going to be childish. I thought Ahsoka was going to be annoying in the first season. I felt like it was going to be the character put there for the kids to, you know, so they can attach to a character. I'm like, oh, it's like me. It's a kid. And we would be, as adults, watching more of the more serious characters like Obi-Wan and Anakin. But I could not have been more wrong. Ahsoka gets some of the best storylines of the entire show. Fantastic storylines. I mean, from when the Trandoshans capture her and force her to be hunted by them, where she's trying to save the young Padawans who can barely use the Force, and these Trandoshans are brutally hunting down and murdering them, to when she is framed for murder and has to go on the run and prove her innocence, and in doing so sees that the Republic has become, is becoming the Empire. The Republic is not what it used to be. Ahsoka has these amazing storylines and is such a unique character in that she left the Jedi Order, but she didn't stop using her lightsabers or the Force. She's just not a Jedi. She's not a Sith. She's not a dark Jedi. She's just in this gray area, using lightsabers, using the Force for whatever she feels is right. And it's an amazing Star Wars story. Then you have Heir to the Empire, which, if you're not familiar, is a novel trilogy from the early 90s written by Timothy Zahn, and is considered by many old school Star Wars fans to be the actual sequels to the original trilogy. They basically follow the story of Luke, Han, Leia, Lando, Chewbacca, all our original cast, as they try to set up the New Republic 5 years after the Battle of Endor. While doing so, they run into a new villain, a very different villain than Vader or the Emperor, Grand Admiral Thrawn. Now, if you're a fan of Star Wars Rebels, you've seen Grand Admiral Thrawn, and I think that rendition of Thrawn is pretty good. I don't think it's as good as the novels. I would highly recommend reading them. But the main point of Thrawn is that Thrawn is not a brute. Thrawn cannot control the Force. He doesn't have supernatural powers or is some mighty, unstoppable warrior. Thrawn's weapon is his mind. He's a brilliant tactician, and he's the only non-human Grand Admiral that the Emperor ever named due to his brilliance and his tactical advantage in the battlefield. He's basically been the Emperor's secret weapon in the Outer Rim. So once the Empire falls and the New Republic takes over, they have no knowledge Thrawn even exists. So when they start losing fleets in the Outer Rim, they go to investigate and, of course, end up engaging with Thrawn. And across the course of the trilogy, we learn his plan to build a massive fleet and massive army basically overnight using this brilliant plan he's come up with. So you're bringing in Ahsoka, a new fan favorite character, and a beloved character. You're tying her in to an iconic villain who is considered by many Star Wars fans to be one of the greatest Star Wars villains of all time. Thrawn is right up there with Prince Xizor and Darth Vader. I mean, he's there. He is a beloved character. And you're tying it into the Heir to the Empire story, which is a trilogy that, again, a lot of people consider the true sequels. And then you're going to take all that and you're bringing back the entire Rebels crew and bringing them into the story, which of course makes sense because we saw Thrawn in Rebels. Of course, he disappears with Ezra when they go into the Lightspeed and are lost. But the point being, bringing all three of these properties together, Disney is betting the bank. Because if this fails, if this show is a Boba Fett, an Obi-Wan, if it's poorly thought out, if it's poorly made, if it's rushed, if it's a cash grab, they're going to burn three different bridges of fans. Rebels has a fan base. Ahsoka has a fan base. And there are old school fans who still love Thrawn and the trilogy, the Heir to the Empire trilogy. So if this show comes off as anything but very well done, Disney has the potential to burn the remainder of their Star Wars fans. And that makes it such a dangerous move. Now, watching the trailer, I don't think this show looks like it's going to be bad. It looks like a decent Star Wars show, but it's so hard to tell. I mean, Boba Fett in the trailers, I didn't think looked like a bad show, to be honest. And I don't think Boba Fett's a good show at all. My point being in all of this is that I think this is a last-ditch effort. Disney's kind of going all in. They're putting all the chips on the table. We're going to bet Ahsoka, Thrawn, and the Rebels. And if this show does not succeed, I don't know what the future of Disney Plus Star Wars is going to look like. Because I don't think Disney's going to keep sinking money into properties that aren't bringing money back to them. Especially when you've already sacrificed two iconic characters in Boba Fett and Obi-Wan to very little success. And that's not even to mention the Solo movie, which I actually like the Solo movie, but that's another iconic character who got his own story that bombed, that didn't, the first Star Wars movie in history to not make money. And I don't blame Solo for that. I actually think Solo is a good movie. I actually enjoy it a lot. I blame that on, I can't even think of the name of the movie right now, The Last Jedi, and the backlash from that movie, because this Solo came out immediately after that. Point being, to me, Ahsoka has the chance to save Disney Plus. If this show is really good, if this show is great, hopefully this show is fantastic. Hopefully we come in here and we get a knockout show that ties in the Rebels and Ahsoka battling Thrawn together in just an iconic, awesome story. And if it does, I think that the future of Disney Star Wars is bright, because I think that they're really leaning on Star Wars right now, because Marvel is hurting. Let's be honest, like the last Ant-Man movie's just done terribly. And I don't know how the future of Marvel is going to go, but I think if Disney can get Star Wars turned around, they might need to lean on these shows, especially with the announcement that the next movie is going to be a Rey movie, which a lot of people are not excited about. So Disney's making some strange decisions, and the TV shows might be their saving grace. We are supposed to get a movie that ties together this Mandalorian, Ahsoka universe, which could be a really cool movie if, again, it is done right. So, in conclusion, to me, this is it. We're going to find out in a month, I guess, if Disney can pull this off. But I truly believe that if Ahsoka fails, if Ahsoka is a poorly made show, then we're going to get a lot of those Star Wars shows we're supposed to be getting are not going to get made. I think they're going to get canceled. I think we're going to see Disney pulling away from Star Wars a little more. I don't think they're going to keep sinking money into it. I'm really hoping it's a great show. And watching the trailer, I have hope for this show. Again, I think the girl who plays Ahsoka is excellent casting. I really do. I wish I knew her name. I don't know her name. I'm sorry. I'm bad with actresses and actors. Ray Stevenson is in the show, which is a terrible loss. If you're not aware, he died apparently Sunday. He very young. He was only 58. I'm not sure the details of that. Condolences to his family. I've always been a big Ray Stevenson fan. He's one of those actors I feel like he is underrated and should have been in more stuff. So seeing him as this, whatever he is, a dark Jedi Sith, he looks really interesting in the show. So hopefully this is going to be an awesome show. Hopefully in a month or so when the show comes out, I'm sitting back here talking to you guys, talking about how freaking amazing the Ahsoka show was and how I'm looking forward to season two or whatever comes next. But only time will tell. So guys, that's my take on the Ahsoka show and why I feel like it is so pivotal for the future of Star Wars, specifically Star Wars on Disney Plus and the television shows. Please let me know what you guys think down below. Leave a comment. Let me know if you think the show is going to be great, if you're excited for the show, or if you think it's going to be trash and you don't plan on watching it. I'd love to talk to you guys about it. If you haven't subscribed, please do so. I want to keep bringing you guys great Star Wars content. And just so you guys know, the guys who like my game retrospective videos, I am finishing up my Republic Commando video. Should be out early this coming week. The game's been kicking my teeth in the last week or so, I forgot how brutally difficult that game is, but it's been a lot of fun. So thanks for being here again, guys. Please like, please follow the channel, and I hope to see you guys again soon.